They talk say Nigeria and they suffer the world's greatest malaria. They get that one means say anything we concern malaria, it'd be like saying that Nigeria they get the baddest hit with approximately 51 million cases. What would they get every year and over 207,000 deaths? Now they share based on malaria, the female anopheles mosquito bite where they cause that sickness on top of our body. And they talk say 97% of the total population, by the time they put on top number, they talk say now about 173 million people wasted their life, so they are at the risk of getting this kind of infection. And that's now why we they bring come your domot at this point in time concerning malaria. And we get a very casual guest in the building. She now person will be Sabinus on top of this profession. They call him according to the field where she did on top. She now molecular geneticist. Yes, and the focus where she did focus on top of this particular career now malaria drug resistant. Now she don't work for so many places. If you see her track record, you say gonna say this person now bam bam on top this thing, what would they call malaria? She now she don't work as research fellow on top department for international development and the IF, and also she don't get masters in global health science from the University of Oxford and a PhD in clinical medicine and infectious diseases. She didn't even work before as HIV research associate for inside the two top genetic research institutions in the world. Now, nobody, this one she don't only colobi together, she don't colobi plenty awards for inside her very young career, but she has so much to offer on top of the dome. But that now I will don't bring Dr. Ify inside the studio this morning. How you did?
Thanks Dr. for having Ify. Me.
Good to have you, Dr. Ify
Aniebo. Absolutely lovely to be here.
Good to have you. Now, looking at the statistic where Luchi don't bring out, and then make we look at how much has been invested for inside malaria for Nigeria in billions of dollars that they don't invest to make sure, say, they prevent and control malaria in Nigeria. Now, medical experts, they come aside talk, say, we need invest in medical research to combat malaria, patakata. Is that what we really need in Nigeria?
I absolutely think so. I mean, a lot of the research that has gone into Nigeria and into malaria have not really been done in Nigeria. So majority of organizations are based in the United States, United Kingdom, Germany, and other European countries. They're the ones that they've contributed the most to malaria research. And unfortunately, we do not have the capacity here. So for us to actually eradicate malaria, I think science, creating labs and creating the expertise and all of that information would be needed for us to do ground research in Nigeria for that to actually happen. And for that to happen, we need to obviously put a lot of resources into labs, into science research, into education, science education, because it's something that Nigeria isn't really investing a lot in. If we look at the budget for, was it last year, health budget was just really abysmal. So contributing money, the government, there has to be political will for government to put money into research, because our research institutions are not doing as much as they should be doing. And I think that would be the key to actually controlling the infection.
Now, with waiting, she don't come outside talk about the amount of money we don't pump inside, making sure we eradicate malaria. In fact, there was a time when it was almost stop malaria before a certain year. Was it just as we had stopped polio before 2030? We will also get a time frame to eradicate malaria for inside Nigeria. But it can't be like, say, we dey pour water for inside baskets.
Absolutely.
It means say the water doesn't flow, they go everywhere, but we know they see the effect of the water.
Yeah.
Is Nigeria really winning the battle against malaria if we look at now?
No, we're not, because it's rightfully you said, who sets the goals, right? So people say we're going to eradicate malaria in the year 2000, they shift it to 2015, they shift it. It's unrealistic, because the people who set the goals are not people who live in the country. But then African Union presidents came together, most of the presidents that make up the African Union came together and said, 2020 we will eradicate malaria. That's 2 years from today, from now. And that's not possible, because it's not just about setting goals, it's also making sure that you work towards your goals. So we're not putting in what we need to do, what we need to put in. For example, there's drug resistance. So we've got like the first drug that we use, the first line, it's called artemisinins. And I think people would see it's artesunate, lumefantrine. I don't know what the local one is called in Nigeria, perhaps Artemita,
You get different names, different but we don't say
but the basic, the active ingredient is artesunate and lemefantrine. Unfortunately, that has stopped working in Southeast Asia. There's resistance to that.
It has stopped working.
It's not working efficiently, so we need to actually get an IR one. So that's the problem. So the problem with malaria is that the drugs stop working after a while. So it happened in chloroquine, and then we changed first-line basis to sulfadoxin pyrimethamine, and now we're using artemisinins. Southeast Asia is where actually chloroquine resistance started from. It spread to Africa. Sulfadoxin pyrimethamine resistance started again there, spread to Africa. And now
I'm going to come in here because I know, say, for Nigeria here, they talk of what they call double therapy. Now, this active ingredient, where they talk of, now the double therapy, or not just one of the double therapy.
It's the double one. So
now, the double therapy they talk of. So now that double therapy, you know, they're effective.
It's effective in Nigeria so far.
Okay, so far so good.
As far as we know, but we haven't really looked for it. That's another problem. So in Asia, people are looking for these things. There's something called surveillance. They're looking to see if the drug still works. In Nigeria, we're not doing anything like that. Some people have reported they've taken drugs and it didn't clear the parasite. And they go back to the hospital and say they have malaria. So we don't really know because we're not doing science research to find out, okay, is this drug working or not? So we still don't know what's going on in Nigeria. So, but the problem is that we need to understand if the drugs are not working as they should, because if the one we currently use, if it stops working, then we're going to actually be in trouble.
Now, it gets this other one when it comes to giving out information, because you see this kind of way they talk now, a lot of people feel no get access to information like this. Now, another scenario now where I know say the federal government, they try do now to give out mosquito nets, to distribute mosquito nets to various hospitals, general hospitals, to give out. But if you can't check them, I don't deal on top Third Mainland Bridge. That mosquito net where they share for free, did they sell them for Third Mainland Bridge? Did they sell them for certain traffic? You go see, say, some of these resources that are supposed to be given out for free, people still they find out, say, did they buy them?
Yeah.
When they're supposed to get it for free. So how you feel, say, the government fits, make sure, say, orientation of the people, dissemination of information, make people understand, say, okay, we can give whether not free anti-malaria, or whether would they give free the double therapy malaria, or whether would they give free mosquito net, or whatever it is, way to make sure, say, malaria come off of the country. How can the government do better in this dissemination of information?
In terms of dissemination of information, it has to be advocacy. So for example, television, radio, education in schools. Don't wait till the child is literally like in your teenage years. Let them start like from 4, 5, 6. Children are very intelligent. So you have to start when they're really young and make it a normal routine. In terms of mosquito nets being sold, free mosquito nets being sold.
That should be free.
It's an institution problem. Like, there has to be a way that, you know, you don't resell these things that have been given for free. Why are people selling it? You think about it, they want money, right? It all boils down to poverty, right? People are struggling in this country. Like, I think it's terrible. The poverty level is so terrible. So people get their hands on this thing and they sell it because they need money. And it's not right. Some people, you actually distribute nets, but it's not about just giving nets. What's the usage of the nets? How many percentage of people actually use? How many people actually sleep under the nets?
And it also,
that's the problem.
Well, is that the only preventive measures?
So the preventative measures would be insecticide resistant spray, residual spray. So I think you have the
raid. Different kinds of insecticides.
But unfortunately, I don't know if you noticed, some of them don't work as
well. They don't work
They don't work as much. Mm-hmm. That's resistant as well. So you then have to buy a few raids or Bagon and spray like a cocktail of these insecticides. So you need to spray your environment. You need to make sure that you don't have a lot of dirt around. The problem in Nigeria is there's a lot of dirt. We don't treat our sewage properly. We don't get rid of our dirt. It's an open dumping system.
We have open all of drainage, that, proper, exactly, proper drainage system.
Exactly, so and all of that contributes to the vector, which is mosquitoes. Mosquitoes love that. And Nigeria is so humid and warm. They love that environment. They thrive in that environment. So the more our environment gets dirty, it's going to keep thriving. And then we're going to keep getting infected because we're living in a very dirty environment. But treatment is good because it helps us clear that. But it's not sufficient. We can't just keep treating. We need to treat and prevent, and also carry out surveillance. So we know exactly, okay, so what's going on in this government area? Are people responding to treatment? How better can we, you know, manage our resources and direct it to the places that need it? So that's,
Let me just ask you this, Dr. Ify Aniebo. Now, a lot of people, they don't come outside talk, say, why you say would they concentrate so much on malaria eradication for inside Africa in general? Why is so much hype on malaria?
It's not so much about hype. Malaria kills half a million people a year. in Nigeria, people think, oh yeah, it's just, you know, it's flu. It's nothing, mm-hmm. you know, it's mm-hmm. like getting the flu. But it's not. It's a very dangerous disease. If the parasite gets to your brain, you're going to get like something called cerebral malaria. You start hallucinating. And they realize that a lot of people don't really know the symptoms of cerebral malaria. In Nigeria, they think this person has gone mad. Crazy. But it's a parasite going into, it's been in your blood for so long that it's crossed your brain and then it starts to proliferate.
Okay.
It kills. And it okay. kills children under the age of 5. Imagine. Before they actually get to their, you know, it kills them before they get to 5. So it's really important. It's a terrible disease, and it's not something that we should take lightly. Like,
at what stage does it start killing?
So it can kill anyone at any time, but most susceptible people are children under the ages of 5 and pregnant women. They are the most susceptible groups.
Now, if you look at, and I know say we don't, I mean, with the research we don't, they go on around the world, make we even come on Nigeria because we know we're not even there
okay.
yet. Okay, so with the research, why we never get an effective vaccine against malaria? We get vaccine mm-hmm. against polio, we get yeah. vaccine against other sicknesses where they cause a lot of death yeah. for around the world, but why we never get vaccine against malaria?
Actually, there is a vaccine that is being tried at the moment. It's going through clinical trials. It's not 100% coverage, so it wouldn't give you protection 100%. It's about 40% coverage, which
is that effective?
It's not as we would like for it to be. But the thing about malaria is it has a vector, it has a parasite, it has the human. It's a really smart organism. It doesn't just depend on one thing, right? So polio has a host, that's it. The malaria parasite has the mosquito. The mosquito infects them. You have to understand the mosquito, understand the parasites in the blood of the human. So it's so complicated. The cycle is so complicated. You have to, and then when the parasite gets into the blood, there are different areas that it affects, the different stages. It's a very complicated disease. So it looks really simple, but it's so complicated. And so it's really hard to get a vaccine to just hit one target when there are so many other targets mm-hmm. for it. So, I mean, scientists are trying, but I mean, the parasites are really smart.
So, are the parasites so smart that they become so resistant? I remember when we had the queens, where the queens were the most effective. After a while, it can't be like, say, the queen them. No, they work again. Now, we're not the hear of this one where yes. they talk now, where in some countries, you know, they're as effective.
Yes.
So, it'd be like, say, the parasite, they evolve. They follow the
evolution.
They follow the
absolutely. It's natural. So, in life, people would adapt. Right? So, for example, she was saying to me, we're talking about Lagos traffic, and she said, the longer you stay here, you get used to it. It's adaptation, right? So, the parasite sees drugs all the time. It doesn't want to die, right? So, every organism has to survive. That's the instinct. The instinct of evolution is to survive. So, the more you give it a drug, after a while, it knows, okay, this drug affects me here and there, so I'm going to change this thing so that it doesn't affect me anymore. And it's not just parasites, it's just not just malaria parasites, bacteria. We have that with bacterial infections, and there's been reports about, for example, gonorrhea. There's drug-resistant gonorrhea going around. So these organisms, the more you get treated, the more they get treated, the more they see the drug. It causes something called drug pressure, and the more they realize, okay, we need to stop getting affected, and then they change. So it's mutations, that's what it's called. It happens.
So what's the proper treatment for malaria? Because I know, say, a lot of us like me, once I started to take malaria drug, after the second day, I know to say I'm okay, I just let it be.
But that's the thing, you're not okay. So you feel well because the parasite has been reduced, the level of it in your blood has been reduced, and so you don't really have the symptoms, fever and the malaise and all of that stuff because the drug is working. So Atemita or Artemisinin is a really, really amazing drug. They work really fast. So the first day you're fine, but it's still in your blood. And so if you do not finish your course, you're going to get more proliferation. It's going to keep growing and divide. So you're going to still get infection again, sick with malaria.
It's proper to finish.
So you have to finish the whole thing for the whole 3 days. It's very important. And then after that, you need to go to the hospital and check if there's still anything there.
Now, I don't say when I buy malaria drug or when they give malaria drug, they always advise you, say, make you need to take out with certain things. Like, don't take it with multivitamins, or is it not take it with vitamin C? Or I don't say, get some terms where they always tell you, say, if they take malaria drug now, you're not supposed to take this or whether or not. Is it that multivitamins or vitamin C? One of them, especially for children, they will tell you, say, is it milk?
Milk has absorption problems with certain drugs. So I think the best thing is when you buy a drug, so it also depends if it's atemitalamifantrin, atemitapiparaquine, it depends on the combination. It's good to read the leaflets to see what it says.
Yeah, but the ordinary woman waiting for outside there for market, no, so even that, understand. So where
does she?
Mean.
Yeah, but where does she buy it from? From a local pharmacy.
We'll tell them.
So the pharmacist or the chemist should actually tell her, take this 2 times a day. Don't do this. Do this. That's basically their job, right? Mm-hmm. They're supposed to do that. So everyone needs to pulling
down. So we have everyone get their own role to play.
Absolutely.
In
we all have roles to play as the patient or the caregiver.
But let me ask you this question. I see you talk with so much passion to eradicate malaria for inside Wibodo, Nigeria. Why you get so much passion towards this cause?
Well, for starters, I grew up in Nigeria and I got a lot of... I used to be in a hospital every other, literally, month because I was so susceptible to malaria infection. I mean, I've been back, I've had malaria twice already, again, like, in 3 months.
In 3 months.
It's interesting, but I find it, apart from the fact that I got really, like, interested in it when I was younger because I used to get a chloroquine. And then I got side effects from chloroquine. I used to itch a lot. And asked the doctors, why am I itching from this thing? But they never really understood it. And so I got curious, and then after a while, it got changed to sulfadoxypromethamine. And I was like, okay, why is it changing, you know? But it was just something that literally got my attention. And so when I went to university, instead of studying genetics, I understood why it was behaving like that.
It was Why was it?
Because of mutations. Let me explain. You know the X-Men, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So the X-Men are not normal humans because they have extra powers. Right, so they're not like us. So they can, some of them are telepathic, some have extra strength, etc. So that's how malaria parasites become when they mutate. They're not normal parasites that the drug just kills. They're now super bugs. They're mutants. Oh, so they have extra powers to prevent you from killing them. Right?
And the side effect is some of the things that we feel.
So chloroquine, for example, not everyone reacts to chloroquine. I reacted to chloroquine. I used to itch. Some people have chloroquine reactions.
But they always say then when they grew up, they talk say it is normal for you to have that itching, so they will come give you like another drug again to suppress the itching. Is it normal for you to itch?
It's a side effect. So the thing about drugs is it affects someone differently from the next. It affects you differently from the next person. It depends on your drug absorption, your pharmacogenetics, the way your body or your genes, biochemical pathway in your body breaks down the drug. So it's all, it can be genetics, in the environment, whatever it is, but it's different in different people. And so some people would have adverse reactions to certain drugs, while some people would not. So in my situation, I'd have chloroquine with itching side effects because I was susceptible to the side effects. And you might not, but it's not like it's normal, but it's something that would happen. So they'll tell you you're going to get itching. So you get ready for it, you know.
Yeah, because they'll say if you don't take chloroquine now, we're not going to cure this malaria. You need chloroquine to cure it.
Now,
yeah.
The last question we may get to ask now, because now we don't say malaria, no, the infection. Now, I mean, say, I know if it pass to you, unless the mosquito bite you.
Absolutely.
But why it be say for overseas, if they hear say you get malaria, they quarantine you like say na Ebola, where the infectious, Ebola can easily spread it. But malaria, you know, they like that. But why they go still quarantine you that way? And give it that same treatment or service.
Yeah, so malaria used to be all over the world. In America, in England, in Italy, in Portugal, because there was mosquitoes everywhere. Now, everywhere else, it eradicated malaria. It took them a lot of effort. They eradicated it. And the thing about eradicating a disease is you don't chill out because you've eradicated it. You have to keep making sure that it doesn't come back. And so that's one, that's why they do it. Secondly, there are mosquitoes in England. Right? And there's evolution happening. So if I went to England and I had malaria and a mosquito bites me, it's possible that it picks up the parasites in my body and spreads it around. So that's why they're quarantining you, to make sure that it doesn't, another vector does not pick it up and spread it around. Wow. So they want to make sure that you don't reintroduce malaria into their country. System. They spend so much money and so much time eradicating it, and they don't want any reintroduction.
Dr. Ify Aniebo, very, very nice conversation we don't get with you as regards to malaria. But let's take a little bit personal. I know say it's time for us to wrap this interview.
Okay.
But I know say for one particular interview, you come outside, because I'm just wondering how someone like you, where they practice for inside United Kingdom, decide to come down to Nigeria. In your statement, you talk, say, I found that a lot of West African collaborations as regards to science research, they actually happen for inside Kenya, Ghana, and Rwanda, and they're very ahead of Nigeria.
Absolutely.
You see, I can't ask myself this question, why? Reason are because Nigerians, they talk big and don't do the work. Now, taking into consideration, say you don't identify the reason why science research now no for inside Wibodo, Nigeria, why did you decide to come down here?
Well, it's not just one problem. It's also, for example, if the government actually gave money to a lot of these researchers, they will be doing some work. But some of them do have money. They've gotten money from like places like the World Bank, other private organizations that actually give money to fund it, to fund their research, but they don't really do so much. And it might be the climate in Nigeria. There's just something about Nigeria. People just don't, it might be electricity, it might be traffic. It's doing work in Nigeria, doing science work in Nigeria is so difficult. So you kind of have to be extra passionate, extra, exactly, quite extra about it. I have met amazing professors at the University of Lagos who are still trudging on, even when there is no electricity, there's no light, they're still doing so much work. But the reality is our government isn't funding science. And if they are funding science and giving money to these institutions, you're going to get quite a lot of people doing science. I've met a lot of young scientists in so many universities in Nigeria doing research as we speak. Some of them go use their own salaries to buy, you know, fuel for their generators. And it really shouldn't be that way, because a lot of research they're doing is for the betterment of the country, not just for their own personal gain. So investment in science is something that we really need to talk about. It's something the government needs to take seriously. I know the government perhaps has a lot of priorities, but, you know, if we don't want a situation like, I mean, Ebola to happen again, you need frontline workers, you need people who have the expertise, not just the expertise, also the teaching, the training. For example, science education in Nigeria is actually quite poor, right? People are taught to cram. You can't be cramming things that, like, it's not gonna work. Like, it has to be experimental. We don't have labs. You go to a lot, unless you go to a private school, a lot of normal secondary schools, public secondary schools don't have labs. So these students aren't really seeing science, and it's such an amazing, I studied in Nigeria, and I think our science labs were okay at the time, you know? But I think education has gone so bad. It's like in the past 10, 15 years, it's gotten so bad that young people are not, if you talk to a young person, what do you want to be when you grow up? The last thing that they say is a scientist, because they don't see scientists. It doesn't seem cool. And besides, you don't really hear about it. They want to be actresses or comedians.
Musicians, entertainers.
And there's nothing
wrong
with
that. That's what they see.
Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with that, you know? But at the end of the day, if we're going to like stop Ebola, for example,
or Lassa fever,
or any other infection, from, we need to, you know, empower these groups of people.
Invest in science research. Yeah. Very, very nice conversation with you. I'm Dr. Ify Aniebo. She's a molecular geneticist, all right? And she focus on malaria drug resistance. Thank you very much.
Thanks for having
me. Thank you so much. All right, now, so we'll see him on top of this interview. I hope so you enjoy yourself, because I was very, very informed at this point in time. Thank you so much.
Thanks.
Thank you so you come. I hope so next time we invite you.
Absolutely,
you
I will definitely come. Thank you.
Fantastic. Thank you.
Wow. Really nice conversation what we get with Dr. Ify Aniebo. Very nice one, because malaria don't become very, very important disease where we need to treat, or sickness where we need to treat for entire Wabudu, Nigeria. And I like the fact that she come outside talk, say some insecticide not even work again.
Not effective, yes.
They are not effective, so you need to make sure, say every week you they fumigate your house, or
every
you they spray them.
Wow, because when you talk of
fumigation, every week you have to spray.
Okay, yes, and with this
fumigation,
one,
like a month.
Even remind me of those fleets. Remember those fleets we get that time when they full and like the foo foo. I don't want any strong.
I don't want walk past.
And they more effective compared to the one.
If you see them for market, they don't mix some things. Enter.
Exactly, they don't mix, and they try to modernize them now. Even the container, the comb, they try to make it look fresh and all that.
Another one we will talk about where people need to, we need to still reiterate and be say, if you don't start your malaria drug, make sure say you finish them. No come outside talk say after 2 days you are okay. Ah, I know they sick again. Ah, I know they vomit. I know they do. Please make sure say you finish them, because in such way you fit actually commode the parasites.
Exactly. No do we start away after second day. Oh, I feel good. La 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 la. I know that he would now. All right, so we'll see. I'm on top of this particular episode on top of the Good Morning Nigeria show. We go there again to give you everything we share from Monday go reach today, but by tomorrow it will be yesterday. But for now, I remain Chi Enobong, your Niger Halfcast, make you get better day.
And if you actually join us later on, we'll discuss with Dr. Ify Aniebo. You can watch him online, either on top YouTube, follow us at Wazobia TV NG, and then you go watch the interview. My name is Siriman Uvi Ehigamuzo, your one and only Benin Princess. See you again tomorrow in peace and not in pieces.
To enjoy more of this, our Ogbonge videos when you just watch, press this button to subscribe on top of our YouTube page. You go love her.